contain the meeting that we have here this morning. Now, I want to tell you something else. Our forefathers worshiped the Lord wherever that they could find. Amen. And that's a good ideal. This is wonderful. This church started as an outdoor tent revival. Our forefathers talk about having brush arbors. Now, what's that? You say, what? Some of our kids say, what is a brush arbor? Brother Johnny, help me out here. What's a brush arbor? Is that like where they drag a bunch of limbs in a circle and they keep the mosquitoes off of you? What's that? It's an outdoor meeting with limbs as walls?
A lean-to?
Church in the lean-to. You know, this church went from a tent to a house. Praise God. That's Sister Ruby's bedroom used as a Sunday school room. Her mother took this church into her house. Why? Because there wasn't as many of you then. But the church grew, and it's natural to grow. It's natural to grow. And instead of having a church in her house, and a church in this house, and a church in that house, and a church in that house, basically they assembled together as a church and say, hey, it'd be nice if we had a roof over our heads instead of a brush arbor. And it'd be nice if we didn't have to put up the tent every time that we came together. So they grew and they matured and they went to a civic hall or some place that they could rent a little building, and they would meet in there, and then on top of a store building, or had an office front or a storefront church where you can meet. And it's a beautiful thing to naturally progress. And so we have now a wonderful facility that we can worship the Lord in. And when we're all assembled together, there's room enough. I was kind of really taken aback by some of the things that came out of the mentality of this pastor that split this church all to pieces. And I heard a co-worker at work. So this is very relevant to what we're dealing with today, even at work. Why church? A lot of people don't know. A lot of people don't know. They don't have any idea. This man, he goes, yeah, we stopped meeting in the civic center. And now the pastor, he got this idea that we shouldn't have an organized church. And he started a thing in his house. And he said there's no youth or children's ministry because that's not in the Bible. I'm like, dude, which version are you reading, man? Oh, they should teach them at home. Yeah, they should do that. But I'm going to tell you something. There's more to it than that.
Right.
Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together. Now, how does this work when you all get home from work, you're assembling at your house? The church is at your house because we're church. And see, this is what the pervasive thought behind it is church is just the called out people who are serving God. That's the church. It's us rather than a church building. And that's true. 100% true.
Right.
Johnny was talking about the other Wednesday night how that he met some people who ascribe to the same mentality that busted that church up in Bowling Green, that my co-worker at work. And when I see these types of schisms weaving their way into our generation, it's my duty as a pastor to call it out and call it like I see it, according
right.
to the Word of God. And,
right.
and I see that we're supposed to assemble ourselves together.
That's right.
I mean, not just our family. That doesn't make any sense. It says, don't forsake the assembling of yourselves together. How many of us shouldn't go home from work? We assemble ourselves at the dinner table every evening.
Right.
Why would anybody stop doing that? And then the church had... there's a couple of scriptures. Like I said, it would have been easy for Brother Tomlinson or the state overseer of Florida to write a letter to Sister Martha Jane and say, to the church that is in your house, while it was in her house. He wrote one to the church at Palm Harbor when there was a tent. So sure, the church supersedes the walls. And when we talk about the church, we really need to focus on us as as individuals and as a collective body, not just the building or not just where we meet. And really, it doesn't matter where we meet, but that we do meet.
Right.
I would be happy to meet in a stadium.
Amen.
Whether or not it had a roof. Now, you think about that now for a moment. Sold out football games in stadiums without roofs while it's raining. And to see your team lose, you put on the gear that it takes to weather the weather. Would you do that for church? I think I'll stay home and read my Bible today. I'll read my Bible though, Pastor. Good, good. I'm glad you're reading your Bible. Read this one. Let's not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. As such as may. There are letters in the New Testament that say to the church that is in such and such house, about three or four times to the church. And I'm glad those letters are there because that means somebody opened their home up. Maybe they had a big den.
Right.
Opened their home up and said, hey, listen, we're going to have a meeting. And some churches, they have to meet in secret. There was just a crackdown over in China about people having church at all. Mm-hmm. And people being imprisoned and beaten because they believe in Jesus. And here we want to attack the church. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, Paul addressed his letter unto the church of God, which is at Corinth. The church of God was there at Corinth. Paul says, 1 chapter, 2nd verse, to them that are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's a beautiful scripture. To the church of God, which is at Corinth. That's a group of people. Sure. It sounds like that group of people was at Corinth. Sure. Then there are some that in like I said, are in houses. 1 Timothy, turn with me if you would. This is the last scripture, so if you had any worries. 1 Timothy, the 3rd chapter, in the 15th verse. It says, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. As I look through this scripture, this is where that bishops and deacons get their critique of what they're supposed to be, what type of men that they're supposed to be. And one of those jumped out at me. It says, one that ruleth his own house well. And I thought the church was in his house. Wouldn't that just go hand in hand then? No, you got to first at home. You got to have your affairs in order at home. Why church? It's a beautiful thought. Have you thought about it? You know, I'm going to tell you something. I have seen a lot of different veins and avenues of thought. Some of them are healthy. Some of them are not so healthy. I've learned to focus on that which is good, hold on to that which is good, and to eschew that which is evil, or push it away. I don't want any of that. And today, as a generation, we're faced with the same questions that every generation's faced with. Why church? Why God? Did you know that there are people now that don't even believe in God? That there are third world countries that are wanting to send missionaries to America to see people saved and learn about God and about church. Tides are changing. Generations are changing. All the same questions are really coming up again and again. And you can see it through church history. And I looked online, the oldest church in the world. And it was a good little study. And if we would go back there, we'd be in a cave. I'm glad we progressed a little bit. Amen? I'm glad we progressed a little bit. The first buildings show up around that are still standing. Some of them were converted synagogues. Imagine that, if Paul went to a city, went to the synagogue or the temple, and everybody got saved, and so they just continued worshiping without the veil in the temple.
Right.
It'd be a beautiful thought. That some of those buildings could still be standing. The Church of the Nativity. Beautiful study. Some of these old buildings are over 1,700 years old. And now you're going to fall for, oh, you don't have to go to church. Just stay at home. Have your fellowship. I know some of these are funny. I hope that they triggered something in your mind that will help you. I do want to say that I have seen lives changed. Amen?
That's right.
From unbelief to belief, to where that when presented with that fact that there are people who don't even believe, it's not an awe to me, it's an opportunity to me. Amen. That I might, in the gifts that the Lord has shared with me, edify the body of Christ by building one another up. I hope that we'll be able to continue next Sunday on a similar thought, because there's a reason that all of this giftedness and all of this talent comes together.
That's right.
And it's for you. It's for you, and it's for your children, and it's for your children's children, as many as the Lord our God shall call. Will you stand with me this morning?